know you. It's not like I don't know you. My dentist is here. My cardiologist is here. My tennis pro is here. Okay, there's a lot of me in this show, so here's the thing. So that I don't look arrogant, egocentric, which totally am, but I'm going to try not to sing that one. I'm going to fade back to the piano. I'm going to accompany these fabulous singers, which is about as much fun as you can have. John and Susie, you're here.
Dude.
Here's the great thing about John McCartney. He does a radio show that went all over the world that we've worked on in 1985. When he likes something, you know that little pause that a song ends, and there's a little pause before the pause? In that pause, you're gonna, here's what you're gonna do.
Outstanding!
Yes, that's what you're and you're gonna know that that's John. So here we are with the music business. At the Butler School of Music, we're just delighted to be here in this space. I don't think 109, as we call it, has ever performed in this hall other than for a few reflective things for incoming freshmen. Y'all come on in. You're not in JR. Come on in. JR, one of the greatest guitar players in Austin. And my ears.
You can't hear me very well back here.
Really? What if I talk like this?
Really? Can you make it louder?
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, is that better?
Yeah.
No, I've created a monster. Let's do it in unison.
Outstanding!
That's what we need. Okay, I know that I watched Mariella Poole, the director of the Butler School of Music, walk in here. Mariella, where are you? Thank you for letting us exist. We're happy to be here in your presence. Yes. Martha Hilly is here. What if she's like, she's kind of like the queen bee. If there's a problem, you go to him. And she and I were at the same university when I was an undergraduate. I think you were a graduate. And she is a piano faculty here, which is, I kind of wish she hadn't shown up for this one. I can apologize to the beautiful Steinway right now for what is about to happen to it, but that's okay. So we have other professors. Randolph Bias is back there from some other part of the campus that I don't understand. We've got all kinds of fascinating people. I wish you all knew each other, but you don't. Even my therapist when I was 41 is here. You can just see if you can figure out who she is. She'll be the one going, oh, shit. Right, or texting me in the middle of a song. We don't know. Amy is here, my lovely wife that I love, and she's and, well, y'all all know her, that's kind of cool. How many parents do we have here from our folks? Pretty good number. And you all seem like pretty reasonable people. Grandparents, how many grandparents? Okay, we can have a club of two. Cool. This music thing is, it's unbelievably powerful, and you wonder why your kids get hooked on it. And it seems crazy that they should be attracted to this and look at it as a career. My parents, when I told them I was driving to pre-med school at Texas A&M, and I told them, you know, I don't think I want to be a doctor. I think I want to study music. After the wreck, they kind of gathered themselves and said, we are really driving you to the wrong university. I said, let it be. I'll switch after one semester of hanging from pipes at Texas A&M and doing 1,000 push-ups a day. And the first 20 years were hard, and then it got better, and it got better, and it got better, and it turned into a career. So you're going to hear songs that were created. All of these songs were published. And they are in chronological order. So you'll see the maturation of a young man that starts when I was, I think the first one I was 26 or 7, up until a couple weeks ago. Katie, it's you. Oh, beautiful, Katie. How many former members of Ensemble 109 are in this room? One, two, three, four, five, 20. Awesome. All right, thank you. Here's what happened. Everything was going along fine. And then our media people learned that it's easier to make a star than it is to make a musician. So we have taken the popular arts, which used to be pretty rich. In the 60s, it was pretty rich. 50s was a mess. 60s began to become rich with Crosby, Stills, and Nash, and even Toto came along, and when was that, early 80s? We had a 25-year run of having fabulous popular arts music. What about Earth, Wind, and Fire? But then we got hooked on the celebrity thing, and they found it was much cheaper just to make a star out of somebody that was willing to do anything, and that they could actually, I'm saying they, I mean the record companies and all the people there involved, they could actually own the property. And then the property becomes the thing that we sell, and then the music goes lower and lower and lower and lower until there's pretty much nothing left except celebrity. This is where we are. This is why God put music schools on the earth. And this is why I wanted to write music. So as I've matured over the years, I've cared less and less and less about how big the audience is. And what is the point of turning 65, which I did a while ago, and a couple weeks ago, and what is the point if I don't myself reach for something that is absolutely worthless to the culture as we know it now? Right? If I don't take the chance, how are these students in the university going to take a chance? So this is a little bit of a experiment in how deep can we go, and will any of you go with us? I'm saying that you will, because you're all my friends, and there's no way it's going to go any other way. But I'm so happy. Paul Baker is here, one of our great players, and so 109 is designed to teach singers in the recording studio arts and make them into what we call, and nobody knows this term, recording session singers. In other words, they get hired to sing background vocals, lead vocals, all kinds of things in the recording arts in every little town in the United States. And so 109, we spend every rehearsal making up things, trying things, making up songs, adding harmonies, doing anything we can do, and stretching everything, which is more about the ear than it is about the voice. So if you don't like the voice, I guarantee you, you will love the ear. Because you're gonna hear the voice do things that nobody would think of doing. These are individuals, and I keep them as individuals. It's not a choir. It's not a homogenous sound, except sometimes it is. And so this idea of a recording session singer is really important. And many of the singers that came out of this group continued to do it. So to drive it home, that so you understand this as a career path, we tonight are not bad indeed. Thanks to this tennis guy. Okay, so I want to say that this is the first time we're having Ensemble 109 Studio Session Singer of the Year Award. We thought it up this afternoon. Okay. It happened pretty quickly, but we're doing it anyway, and it doesn't have to be anybody associated with Ensemble 109. It needs to be somebody that I've worked with personally, and I can verify that they're fabulous. This person, and I want you to meet him, and then we're going to talk about him a little bit, is the unbelievable talent of Craig Tungate. Come up here, Tungate. Yeah.
A sweet bass as lucky can be. Chim chimini, chim chimini, chim chim chirin. Good luck when I shake hands with you.
So, Walt Disney Records wanted to remake all of their hit songs in a catalog. So we re-recorded and reproduced 67 songs of all of their hit songs. Now these are some of the most well-loved characters in the world. And so we redid Robin Williams stuff from Aladdin. We did everything over from, what's the one with the
Jungle Book, Pinocchio.
What's the one with the French chef?
Oh, Little Mermaid.
Little Mermaid. And so those needed character singers. Now, this is a rich baritone, beautiful, could be a legit opera singer, but he can also sound like anybody in the world. And he's sung over 50 songs for Walt Disney Records, even When You Wish Upon a Star, which happened in one meeting, and he just sung The Toilet
and Necessity.
He did that. And then we were just learning how fabulous Craig was, and the clients were there, and they said, can he sing When You Wish Upon a Star from Bare Necessity? Mm-hmm. I said, Craig, have you got When You Wish Upon a Star? He said, can you give me 15 minutes? I need to shift gears a little bit. So I did. All I had cut was the piano and a click track, a metronome. That's all we had. The orchestra wasn't there yet. And we ran through, we got levels, which means the recording, the technical part. And then he sang it in one take. And they were all crying, and they flipped out. And I flipped out. And then I hugged him because he saved the dad. Nobody that could sing that song. This is Craig Tunde. He's the most virtual singer. Virtual? I just went in the web world or something. You know, man, you're totally here. No. Virtuous? They're going to be rowdy. Okay, versatile.
I'll take it.
Right, singer I've ever met in my life. And I bought these for you 10 years ago. This is Craig sang every character when Disney decided to remake everything from Little Mary Poppins. What's the guy's name that did the laughing song?
Edwin.
He did all these voices, and there was no possible way to know that it was the same person doing all of them.
I love the laugh.
Yeah, that's it. They made big money for me. How did it do for you? Not as good. Anyway, you're going to get some kind of award when we think about this more than a couple hours. Right? And I love you. I'm so happy you're here. And I'm so happy that you get to hear these kids.
Me too.
They're not kids, really. I can't wait for you to hear.
And your songs. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. Craig Tunde. After the concert, we're going to go to the music building east, or to go out the door and around to the next building over. It's a 1.5 minute walk, and it's another big choir room, and we've got a huge spread of food. I mean, it's not just chips and dips, it's the real thing, and we've got enough for all of you. So we'd like you to come. Maybe Craig will sing. There's a piano in there. We've got a PA system in there. We're going to have some fun. So if you can, stay with us and come join us in the right now, we're going to start with the very first song. It's sung by one of our two voice majors, Jordan Ashworth. And he's got his own fan club. And we're going to do the first song without microphones in honor of this room. And then we'll crank it up. Thank you.
There's nothing can go wrong for long. I'm riding in the dawn, but I'm forever in the song.
Thank you. first album, The Music Is Everything, was released in 1981. Although depressing like every great breakup song, Gary reports that the duet Do You Cry was not a true story.
What's up with all the questions? Was it wrong? Do you cry? We think it may be possible that the cheating girlfriend in Do You Cry is still alive, and even here tonight. Let's find out.
Here's double E major, Maniv Aya, and psychology major, Rachel Lieberman.
Oh, baby, Far right.
Bottom right. Yeah.
Feelin Is Mine, with the title song sung by business administration major Craig Boudreau. We've now learned that relationships with 109 singers seem to last for life. So tonight, we welcome the founding member of Ensemble 109 to sing his signature song from 30 years ago, The Feelin Is Mine.
Dr. Craig Boudreau!
In 1985, Gary wrote his version. version of Kyrie Eleison from the Catholic Mass as an exercise for one of my singers to answer this question. What happens when classically influenced part writing intersects with popular vocal stylizations? Austin's NPR radio station, KUT, picked up the story and interviewed Gary while playing his recording of Kyrie.
When returning home, Gary found voicemails from two of Austin's artistic directors, Lambros Lambrow of Ballet Austin and Greg Easley of Austin Contemporary Ballet, who were both listening to the interview and Kyrie Eleison at the same time.
Greg Easley explained...
Sorry.
Greg Easley explained how AIDS had taken its toll on the dance community at large and also shared how he felt this Kyrie had spoken to his own sense of loss. Then Greg asked, would you be more interested in expanding your Kyrie to look more deeply into loss itself? Not directly as an AIDS piece, because all of us live with loss every day. Thus, the bigger idea for this ballet was born, entitled Rhapsody of the Soul, and performed at Austin's Paramount Theater on February 9, 1996.
Who would have guessed a college ensemble would evoke such a wonderful reaction from two ballet companies? And although now 30 years old, Kyrie remains a staple of Ensemble 109 performances.
Thank you.
of Walt Disney Records.
This story lasts 20 years, so here's the Reader's Digest version. Disney.
Have any singers in Austin, Gary?
Yes, come to Austin and I'll show you.
So Disney... showcase of his professional singers, his private students, and us, Ensemble 109. The perfect export model for 109 singers was born. 20 years later...
Gary had aged 40 years.
You rewrote that.
No, I didn't. You wrote this.
However, he had produced over 1,500 songs and scores selling some 47 million records in 69 countries. Within that number, Disney published... Within that number, Disney published 152 of his songs, 37 of which he co-wrote with his frequent collaborator, Austin songwriter Chris Martin.
All that said, we figured that without Ensemble 109, nothing would have ever happened, right?
Right.
Yeah, right.
Recent UT Concerto Festival winner, violist Alice Ting from Los Angeles. Her talent swings both ways when it comes to music. She joined 109 in this, her last year at the Butler School, where she is totally the queen of the jungle.
I just would like to reiterate that that swings both ways comment is really strictly musical.
Oh,
sassy pants over here, and our corporate communications major, Ashton Talley, sings the unlikely peaceful resolution of a Chris Martin lyric for the song Stars, released on three separate Disney albums. With the original track.
Yes.
Stars made for wishing, and stars made for fishing, beneath the full moon on a long summer night. There are stars made for gleaming, and stars made for dreaming, and stars made to be such a beautiful sight.
At the moment of our birth, what would be the first words you would most want to hear. As a tribute to humanity, this song in my poem is just that, and has now been translated into Spanish, French, Portuguese, German, Russian, and Hebrew. Tonight, you'll hear In My Poem sung in English by our keeper of sweetness with her smooth and gentle soul, Miss Jenna Kate Long.
To be chosen by mine. Choose now if we stay or go. We have no worries. Little round bodies, maybe no time.
Well,
here I go.
Cuando el día se
So
one. In other words, an audition, until finally finding his match.
At age 61.
Amy Hurst. Architecture, medicine, diplomacy. ask the rest of the world.
This is what Gary asked Jamie's father over dinner. You see, Ralph Person is a scholar of theology, philosophy, with a doctorate in church history. He answered the question in 8 words. You have to understand Aristotle to get this.
Well, this story is huge. It should be made into a musical, Gary says. So 3 years later, the theatrical concert, Aristotle's Prayer, was born and first performed in 2012.
Now there will be a short quiz after this, so pay attention and hang on. We've just left Disney World and the pop world of music. That's all you really need to know. But for now, he wrote this, okay? But for now, you'll hear 4 of these songs as a taster, starting with our voice major from Galveston, Mary Grosso, and music production major from Flower Mound, Texas, in his first semester with 109, Mitch Webb.
When a young girl struggles with the truth of her story, the relationship between knowledge, self, and beauty intertwine. A Chance for Beauty, Mitch Webb.
production in the popular culture where we actually live. The chasm between these two places compels us to engage bigger ideas in order to stretch our capacity for understanding, and hopefully, not just finding, but creating a reflection of our own life. This song's lyric is the thesis statement for this show. Aristotle's prayer. It's hope. It's a prayer. It's an altar call, and yet has no religiosities. The big idea is this. The world can be known, and our ability to reason remains our best hope for surviving. This is as expressed by Aristotle some 2,300 years ago, and is an idea still struggling. Check out my partner in crime, voice major Jordan Ashworth, singing Aristotle's prayer.
Beauty lay before. Finding the best use of our individual nature hardly has any place for habit. Let's try this instead.
So, are habits bad?
Okay, I've still got you on habits. No, they're quite useful when you need to find your car keys.
What are thoughts if not just thinking habits?
No, this is way too early for that.
So, are you talking about habits within thought, thinking itself, or habits of
what else? And who raised you?
Are we not done with habits? What about habits of behavior?
You are too much. I mean, really, who are you really?
Well, I'm not sure which part of me, you know, is me, and which part is someone else.
You'll know in time.
So time is on my side, huh?
You're 9 years old. Give it a chance.
Yeah. I'm not sure. I think we should just leave our lives to chance, or rely on our virtue, do you?
You mean personal responsibility as some kind of safety net? You do know this is a show, right?
Yes, I know, but I need to understand the part I have in all of this, you know? In chance, in the grace within myself, and evidently now, have it.
Again, were you raised by monks or possibly wolves?
I understand without knowing. And I feel pain, but I don't know where it comes from, or whose pain it is.
You.
Grace lives outside of habit, right?
You are
what? Finish it.
You are the pattern of the possible.
Yes, I know.
The pattern of the possible is preferred above the rule.
Well, I do know where the keys are, so I don't need grace for that.
Ah, patterns of possibility.
Are you sad?
Not tonight, but am I making you sad?
I am, but like I said, I don't know where it comes from. How sad can a person be and not just die from it?
Oh, very, very sad. But hope and grace, they sit pretty close to one another.
Am I going to need grace at some point in the future?
More than likely you will. I'll make sure you have it.
I know you will, but why me?
You're sensitive. And you have a big, big, knowing, and willful heart.
But when I do need it, how will I find it? Really? How and where? Is it a gift? When I feel it, will I know where it comes from? What if I need it again later? Is this one of those possibilities that lives outside the rules?
Oh,
Right.